Recording now, all right. And yes, so let us start. I think first is about the knight. Knight is a wonderful piece and a unique piece on the chessboard, right? And it is the only piece that can jump over anything, right? So if you see at the beginning of the chess game, when everything, okay, just give me 1 second. I'm going to be. Just give me 1 second, sorry. Settings, notifications, and I don't want any notifications, and I don't want my mail also to be popping up. Okay, fine, excellent, okay. Outlook is killed. Fine. Excellent. So we'll not have any disturbance. Okay. So going back to our knight and queen. Okay. Arau has also joined. Excellent. So first is knight. Okay. So it is, I was saying that it is the only piece which can jump over anybody else. And at the beginning of the chessboard, normally you will
see. Good evening, sir.
Yes, good evening. So we can only move pawns at the beginning, because all other pieces are blocked. They cannot come out. Bishops, queens, rooks, they cannot move in the beginning, right? Because they need some space and opening to move. But the only thing that is all right. So only piece that can move in the beginning, even though no pawn has moved, is the knight, because the knight can jump. So there are 4 moves that are possible for you if you are playing white, even without moving a single pawn of yours, right? And I'm sure you will know. One is knight to which squares? At the beginning, starting first move you are going to make it f3, right? Arau, you are right. F3 is one of them. Then knight to f3, you can do it. Knight to h3 also you can play. Yeah, I will tell Arau what is the thing. I've seen your question. So f3, h3, and similarly c3 and a3. Correct. Perfect. So not c2, because c2 is, there is a pawn on that. So c3, a3, and no, if you are looking at it from the black side, it is f5 is not possible at the beginning. Only thing that is possible is f6, h6, and A6 and C6. That is what it is. That is what is possible for the knight from the black side without moving a single pawn, right? Okay. So Arav has asked, why is it that a knight moves only in the like a L shape? What is shown here? So that is the rule of the game. Okay. So why you cannot really question, because that is how the game has been designed. Okay. So there is an interesting thing. When you reach the level 3 class, right? I have a special section on the history of chess. But yeah.
Does the knight only move in L because the face of the horse is L?
Because the what of the
horse F? Is like this. So L.
Yeah. The knight moves at L, but you asked, is it because of something F? What is that F? I didn't get. You asked me a question. Is it that the knight moves only in the shape of L because something? I didn't get it. Can you repeat again?
I didn't write because.
Okay. Okay. So then it is okay. See, this is the rule of the game, and that's how you have to play it. So there was no other piece that was that had the jumping power. And see, traditionally the chess game evolved with why queen does not move. Okay, so somebody is asking why queen does not move. So that is because the game has its parallels on the actual battlefield. Okay, earlier kings used to make battles with each other, and that time there used to be footmen. There used to be charioteers, there used to be horsemen, right? And sometimes elephants also used to be there. So see, among this, if you really see, if you are a horse rider or something, you will know that the horses can actually jump physically. If you are riding a jump, you might have seen the obstacle course, how the horses jump over it. Bishops, which are camels, do not jump. Okay, do not jump. Maybe small jumps they do, but they do not really do a big jump. Similarly, elephants never really jump. Have you ever seen an elephant jump? No. Right? They can run, but they can push, but they cannot jump. Right? And typically king and queen are always sitting on top of the elephant. Okay, so again, that was the reason why the king and queen were not given the thing. But horses, from earliest times, people knew that horses and horse riders can jump, sometimes over a fence also, sometimes over whatever it is, good 5-6 feet also height, they can actually, horses can jump. So that is what has been inherited into the chess, and that is why the horse, which we call it as a knight as in nothing but somebody who is riding a horse in a particular thing. At medieval times, they generally they were the knights, and that is why it is called as a knight. Okay, so that is the background of why the knight jumps, and no other pieces jump. Okay, so I hope it is clear. Now you know I have explained. I think you already know, and I have explained how the knight can jump. And like here, for example, there is a very interesting position. Even if a knight is surrounded by on all sides by some of its own pieces or of other pieces, it alone is a piece which can actually still jump and make all the 8 possible moves, right? So that is what is just shown here, just illustration that it does, it jumps over its own pieces as well as opponent's pieces. It doesn't get blocked. See, a knight never gets blocked. See, you might say that a bishop might have got blocked either because of some of its own pawns on the board or some other piece of its own color on the board. And the bishop can also be blocked, as in technically you don't call it as block, but opponent's piece or pawn or something is there. Obviously the bishop cannot go beyond that. At the most, it will have to kill that pawn and then only proceed, but it cannot directly attack anything which is beyond that pawn or piece of the opponent's side or of its own side, right? And same is true for the rook, same is true for the queen. And knight is the only piece which can jump, which cannot get blocked. And the significance of this, we are going to utilize it in the next class, because when a knight gives a check, pretty much there are very few options. Either you have to kill the knight if possible, or the king has to move. There is no way of blocking. Anyway, let's hold on for the check thing in the next week's class. Okay, fine. So knight, we have seen it. And now, there were some questions that I had asked. So there is a knight here on e2 in this diagram, right? There is a knight on e2 square, white knight, and there is a black pawn on e3 square. Now in this, assume that the white knight needs to land on e3 square, which is the next square to it itself, but obviously the knight moves only in L shape. So do you know how many moves it will take to reach from e2 to e3? Okay, Arav is saying 3. A lot of people are saying, second Arav is also saying 3. Anup is also saying 3. And I think all of you are correct. Okay, in this case, it will take 3 moves. Okay, and that is the beauty of it, right? In all other types of pieces for moving just one square next to itself, they would have just taken one move. But including king, but knight, sometimes some faraway piece it can land in one move, but something which is very close by, it might take more moves. Like in this first diagram, it is going to take 3 moves. Okay, we come to the second diagram. How many moves the black knight will take to reach from f1 to h3? Okay, I think all of you have, most of you who have seen the video and also practiced, I think you are right. 4 moves it takes. Okay, from this pattern, it takes 4 moves in the second position. All right, I think so. You have got the knight. So there is an interesting exercise I'm going to give, or I'm going to share it on WhatsApp at the end of the class today sometime, which I will ask, if you place your knight on say any of the central squares, you can put it on D4 or E4 or E5 or D5, the core center, any of them. And for all the rest of the squares on the chessboard, you should write down how many minimum moves the knight from whichever is the central square that you have put it. You should tell, I'm going to put my knight on. Okay, or for simplicity's sake, let us all put the knight on D4. Okay, this is the exercise for you for doing tomorrow. Okay, put the knight on D4, any color, doesn't matter, nothing else, only one knight. Now on all the other squares of the chessboard, you need to write a number, and that number will be no, that's okay, Aidan, that's okay, you don't need to rename. So yeah, so that what you need to write in that square on each square of the board is how many minimum moves it will take for the knight that is on D4 to reach that square. For example, I can tell you, if the knight is on D4 square, on C6, the answer will be, or the answer will be 1, because from D4, the knight can reach in one move on C6, okay? But on E6, it will be, answer will be 2, because the knight has to move to some place and then land on E6 from D4. Sorry, not E6, D6 I am saying. Okay, D6. So the knight is originally on D4. To reach D6, it will take 2 moves. Okay, so this way you have to do it for all the 3 remaining squares of the chessboard. If you do that, then I think you will become a super confident on how the knight moves. Okay? All right. Any questions on knight? Okay, I think you all are probably familiar with the knight. And then we had come to the queen. So I hope you have, most of you have, or all of you have watched the video. I know Bhavin said he is yet to watch, but I hope all of you have watched the second video which I had sent, which is about the queen. Okay, Arav has watched, okay. And okay, all right, let us see. So, and as you can see in this handout also that I had shown, okay, Vihan is also saying yes, which is good. So if you can see here, so queen is the most powerful piece on the chessboard, barring the king, because king is infinitely important. You cannot exchange a king for anything, but queen is the most powerful piece which can be exchanged or killed, etc. King can never be killed, right? Because it will lead to the end of the game before that. So, but queen can be killed, right? So yeah, you are right. Arav is right. And I've shown it. Queen controls 27 squares when it is in the central core center of the chessboard. And if you remember our, how in the last class that we were, or class before that, second week, we were looking at it. Centralization is important. And so queen from the core center squares, which is E4, D4 or E5 or D5, it can control a whopping 27 squares of the chessboard. There are only 64 total. 27 out of 64 is almost 40-45%. Okay, so imagine that is that much of the chessboard is, can get covered by a centralized queen. And that is the reason why queen is so important. So important, right? Oh, and it starts from the edge of the board. If you still remember what we had looked at it, edge of the board, bishop controls 7 squares at the edge of the board, anywhere on the outer periphery of the board. And then it becomes 9 for the next, then it becomes 11, and then it becomes 13. But the rook is always controlling 14 squares, no matter where you are placing it. So, and the queen being the combination of rook and bishop, you can say, because you can move in both of those things simultaneously, right? So queen will start from 14 plus 7, 21 squares at the edge of the chessboard, and all the way up to 27 squares when it is centralized, right? So that is the power of the queen. And because it attacks, see, you can see it here, queen attacks in 8 directions. 4 directions are straight. Okay, like you have shown here, 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 one direction, second direction, third direction, and fourth direction. These are all straight, like rook-like moves going straight. And then it also moves like bishop, because of which there are diagonals that also it can attack 1, 2, 3, 4. So essentially a queen can simultaneously force or create a force or an impact on the chessboard in 8 different directions, right? So that is the power. And I think we had just looked at some examples like here. See how it can attack multiple things simultaneously, not just one or two, but it can attack several things simultaneously at the most powerful position. Where we can look at is, if we had looked at this thing, handout had been given. See, this is the position where queen is attacking so many squares, eight of the opponent's pieces. A black queen on e5 here in this diagram, it is shown that it is attacking so many of the opponent's pieces, 8 pieces simultaneously, right? That is the maximum that that any piece, if you see how many maximum ways that it can attack opponent at simultaneously. So it comes to rook will be able to attack at the most 4, not more than that. Bishop also will be 4, right? Knight at the most it will be able to attack 8, because it is jumping. If you see the way that the knight moves, it is 8, and queen is also able to attack 8 pieces simultaneously, right? So this is another special way of the knight, because unlike so many other pieces which can, though they are very powerful, rook is very powerful, bishop is also very powerful on the board, but it can hit only 4 different targets at maximum at the same time. But a knight can hit 8 targets at the same time, almost same as it is the same as the queen. Only thing is that queen can attack in a different way, knight can attack in another way. And this is the reason why the knights and the queen combine together very well. So when you are attacking, especially if there is a knight and a queen of yours and the opponent does not have a knight, let us say, or something on the properly, then these guys can combine really well. We will see some examples later on where the queen and the knight combine together, and one of the world's greatest experts of using the knight and queen together is our own Vishwanathan Anand. Okay, he is legendary in how creating an attack from nothing which is there is a king you showed in the second picture is this or which one, I'm not sure which picture you mean. There is no king in the second picture here. And now when we are showing the queen, that time also, let me see if there is a picture. No, there is no king in these pictures. So maybe on H1, maybe on the video you are seeing. Video, sometimes I have to put the kings. Just because I'm not able to create a position without kings. That is the reason. Okay, in the videos. So, because I'm using a software which says if there is no king, then it says illegal position, right? Obviously, it thinks, well, how can you be? But that is not the point here. Why I'm showing these are all synthetic positions without the king, you will see. Not because you can play like this, okay, without kings. You cannot play it. It is just that I want to focus on a specific aspect of the game, and hence only that aspect I have put it. Obviously, in any chess game, there will be both the kings present. Okay. But for simplicity's sake, I'm not showing them. I'm showing you partial view of the chessboard and just trying to drive home the point how this happens. Right. Okay. So that was the thing, and I hope you got this how queen can come to a square from where it can attack all other pieces, right, which are there on the board. I've just shown some examples how it is. All right, I hope any question on the queen and this one.
So if we don't have any questions, should we leave the meeting or should we stay?
Just hold on. So I had given this position and I had asked white to play and win. Again, I have not shown the kings because I just want to focus on how you utilize the specific thing. So let us see. Queen H8. Okay, Queen H8. You are right. You're right. Queen H8 is a good move in this position, obviously. And the reason being that all of the black's pawns are blocked. So they have to move either the rook or the bishop. Whichever they move after Queen H8, the other thing will get captured. Right? So I hope all of you got it. It's a very simple thing, but still you need to just see. And again, there is a concept of a waiting move here. See, right now after Queen H8, while the bishop on B8 is attacked, but it is also defended by the black rook. So as such, it is not an attack. Only thing is that what you have to understand special in this position is that black cannot just pass. Okay, if black could pass, for example, this is one of the key aspects that you have to remember. In some games, like in some card games, etc., you have the option of saying pass. I don't want to do anything in this round, right? Unfortunately, that is not possible in chess. So every player has to make a move after the other player has made it. So white, black. At no point can you say that, you know what, I want to pass my move. You make another move and let me think after that. If that were possible, then there would, the rules of the chess and the game way it comes out, it would have been totally different. For example, in this position, if black were to allowed to pass the move, then black will simply not move at all, because whatever it moves, it will be losing after Queen H8. But if it does not do anything, then white queen has no way that it can kill anything and create a thing. Because what will happen? Queen has gone to H8. Okay. So no matter what happens, so it will not be able to kill anything, because everything is perfectly defended from the black side. The pawns on A5 is defended by the pawn on B6. The pawn on B6 is defended by the pawn on C7. Pawn on C7 is defended by the bishop on B8. And the bishop is defended by the rook on A8. So everything is, as of now, it is perfectly defended, right? So if at all there was a possibility of a passing a move, there was no way that white could have done anything. No way, absolutely. Okay, with the queen. But because there is no such thing, so there is a special name for this. We will cover it probably in the L2 class, but called, as some of you may know it, it is called as Zugzwang. It's a German term. Zugzwang means a position where you ideally don't want to move, because it is already, the position is such that you are in the best possible position at that point of time, and any move you make will be worse for you. Okay, and because there is no option to pass the move, you are forced to make some move, and that forcing of making a move actually will lead to your loss. Okay, this thing happens in chess sometimes. You have to understand it. We will cover it in depth later on. But here, this is one such position. Queen to H8 is a Zugzwang position. Black does not want to move anything, but he has no option other than moving something. Pawns cannot move. So it has to either move the bishop to A7 or the rook to A7 or A6. See, we will not consider trivial things like rook to A6, because the pawn will simply take it for free, right? And obviously after that, it will again roll down. So we will not consider rook to A6, but rook to A7, then the bishop will fall. And if bishop to A7, then the rook will fall, because the queen is attacking on the H8 diagonal, right? So that was the move for this. It is fairly simple, but there are these points involved. So that's why I wanted to touch upon, spend 5 minutes on that. Okay.
So can we leave now?
Yes. So I am done now with my pretty much the thing. So if you have any questions on this, so the practice arena is going to start at 7:35. So there are 7 minutes remaining. Okay, and it will run from 7:35 for 55 minutes. It will run going up to 8:30 p.m. India time, whatever is the time in your country. If you are at a different country, then you have to adjust and check. So that is going to be there. And I hope, so I hope this was clear. If there are no more questions, then I'm going to close the class. But let me know if anybody has anything. Aro, you are saying, I do not know whatever you said. What does that mean? I mean, is there any specific thing that you didn't understand, or what is it? What is your question?
Yeah. Sir, whatever you told that Zingzong thingy.
Oh, Zugzwang. Okay. Zugzwang, don't worry too much. Zugzwang, we will cover it later on. In L2 class, there is a proper way that I cover it. But here, I'm just saying that, see, Queen H8, what happens is, black, he gets into a position where he's forced to make a move when ideally he would not like to make a move. But that not being the make option, he makes some move which always results in a bad position for him. Something getting captured, etc. And that is what is Zugzwang. But anyway, don't worry too much. If at all you feel and you want to read it, you can Google it or go on to Wikipedia and just look at what is Zugzwang. But otherwise, forget.
So what's the spelling?
Zugzwang. Zugzwang. Okay. So that is the thing. Anyway, I will send it. I will send a link to Zugzwang on the WhatsApp group so you can read it on Wikipedia what it is. So that is fine. All right. Any other question? I remember Shreya, you had raised a hand. So do you have a question? Okay, maybe you raised it by mistake then. All right. So fine. Any other person, anyone else has any question on the handout or the queen and the knight moves? I guess no, looks like. So if there are no more questions, then I'm okay to close the call. I'm going to, okay, Shreya, you have raised a hand again. Go ahead and ask your question. Okay, so Shreya, you're not typing or you're not telling. So that makes me think that you may have raised the hand by mistake then. Okay, so looks like no, fine. So then let us leave or you can leave right now the class and then join on the live chess for the arena, practice arena. Okay, 55 minutes of practice. So all the best to everybody. Enjoy it. And that is where we will
measure.
Okay.